mute your audio. If you have any questions, please ask me, stop me wherever you have any questions, right? Now, this is a lecture on switching and lightning impulse voltages. So, where these voltages will occur and why, how these voltages will occur, that is our main topic. But I will introduce the topic right from what are all the kinds of voltages that occur in transmission system, which we need to test the power equipment. So, these are my contact details. So, anytime you are welcome to interact with me. Now, let us go to voltage stresses. See, you know, transmission systems, generating systems, from generating station, the voltage is developed at a particular voltage and then it is stepped up and then transmitted and then again stepped down and then distributed to the distribution network. So, this is briefly the system. So, the transmission, on transmission we are talking about today. So, transmission will happen, you know, using overhead transmission also, as well as underground cables or submarine cables in case where there is a water body between two islands or, you know, island and mainland. So, there submarine cables are there for transmitting the power, or underground cables are there, and overhead transmission system. So, overhead transmission system consists of some towers and then conductors or wires hanging to the towers. So, they are in open atmosphere. So, normally the lightning over voltages that we are going to discuss today will occur on such kind of transmission systems. Underground cables, lightning cannot happen. So, but there is another over voltage, that is switching over voltage. So, that will occur. Let us see what are the voltage stresses on the transmission systems. So, can someone talk about these actually? See, first item is normal over voltage. Normal operating voltage. Normal operating voltage means, you know, the transmission system voltage, it may be 66 kV or higher voltages, even 400 kV or 1200 kV maximum that we have in India. So, these voltages for which the transmission line is designed is called normal operating voltage. See, under normal operating voltage, nothing should happen. See, for example, if normal operating voltage itself, if the system fails, then it is of no use, right? So, under normal operating voltage, the power system components should work perfectly for at least 30-40 years. Otherwise, such systems are of no use. Therefore, it is expected, the design is expected to meet this condition, that under normal operating voltage, the stresses should not be causing any damage to the transmission system. But of course, you know, over a period of time due to aging and all, so maybe after 30-40 years a transformer may fail or a cable may get damaged or some insulator string may get damaged. So, this is after a long time. But there are over voltages. Over voltages means these are not normal operating voltages. These are over voltages which are not actually desirable over voltages. Desirable voltages. There are again two kinds of over voltages. So, one is external over voltage and another is internal over voltage. So, external over voltage, it is external means what? External to the power system. So, what is external to the power system? Natural phenomena such as lightning. So, the lightning is not a part of the power system, but it is an external environmental phenomena. Outside, it will occur outside. So, this overvoltage, which is caused by lightning, which strikes a transmission line. If a transmission line is struck with this lightning, then certain overvoltage will be developed. So, that is external overvoltage. The second one is internal overvoltage. This is actually not a normal operating voltage, but when you switch on or switch off, or if there is a fault, or there is a fluctuation in the load, so during that time the voltage of the transmission system will get disturbed. So this overvoltage, this kind of overvoltage is called internal overvoltage. And as the voltage level increases, see, natural lightning phenomena has a certain amount of charge, typically certain amount of charge and certain amount of current it will cause when it struck a transmission, when it strikes a transmission line. So, but if the transmission line voltage itself is more, then the voltage that is caused by lightning may not be so much high compared to the voltage that is caused by switching operation. Therefore, external overvoltage assumes internal overvoltage assumes importance at higher voltages, and external overvoltage assumes importance at lower voltage. Means, what is that voltage level? Typically, above 350 kilovolts, internal overvoltages assume significance. Means, you know, the system voltages are so high that you can neglect the lightning phenomena, but switching phenomena cannot be neglected because of the huge overvoltage, system, there will be fluctuations in voltage or oscillations in voltage due to internal switching or lightning, switching or fault or fluctuations, etc. So, therefore, you have to concentrate more on internal overvoltage for voltage ratings beyond 350 kilovolt transmission lines. And internal overvoltage magnitude depends on the rated voltage, the instance at which a change in operating conditions occurs, and the complexity of the system, size of the system, etc. So, internal overvoltage is simply due to redistribution of energy within the system. So, it assumes, it depends on these quantities, rated voltage, instance at which a change in operating conditions occurs, time of switching, and the complexity of the system, and so on. Why instance at which a change in operating condition is important? Because when you are switching, whether it is going through a current zero or voltage zero or voltage maximum, these conditions will result in different overvoltage magnitudes. That's why it is important to consider. So, these are the typical voltages that a power system will, you know, meet. Now, actually, whenever we build a transmission line and whenever we install the equipment, before the installation, we do need to test whether the equipment will survive this actual conditions in the field. So, all the equipment such as, you know, transformers, you know, capacitors, or circuit breakers, or whatever equipment that is connected to the transmission system need to be tested in the laboratory whether the equipment is going to survive for these operating conditions or not. So that need to be tested. So the testing has to be done for different voltages. Even normal operating voltage. Normal operating voltage is of what nature? Somebody, what is the waveform? Normal operating voltage. What is the answer? 230 volt. What is the waveform? Voltage level I am not asking. What is the nature of the waveform? Yes, sinusoidal waveform. This is normal operating voltage waveform. Now 230 volts is the distribution line that comes to our home. But transmission level, this is not the transmission level, 230 volts. So transmission will not be in volts at all, it will be in kilovolts, megavolts. Like that you have to speak. For example, 1200 kilovolts means 1.2 megavolts. So transmission has to be at higher voltages. Any reason for that? Why not we transmit the power at 230 volts only? Due to losses. Losses because once the voltage, losses are actually I square R losses, you know. You have to say I square R losses. Losses are mainly due to current. Current means, you know, movement of electrons. So if you increase, power can be same if you have higher voltage and lower current or lower voltage, higher current. In both cases, power can be same. But when you are increasing the current and reducing the voltage, I square R losses will be huge. So that is one reason, that is one of the reasons why we have to transmit the power at higher voltages. So that is why we are going on increasing the voltage levels. So currently ABB has built one transmission line of 1200 kV in India. That is the world's highest voltage level. So that's why we have to go for higher voltages. Now, the equipment need to be tested, as you say, you know, the sinusoidal voltage. First, sinusoidal voltage, the equipment has to survive for 30-40 years, right? So, we need to test the equipment for power frequency, means that sinusoidal voltage. But how to test it? If you test for operating voltage itself, for example, I have a 400 kV transmission line. So there is a transformer associated with that transmission system. That is also rated for 400 kV. Now, if I test for 400 kV, the transformer in a laboratory, and for 1 hour or 1 minute, whatever it is, then if nothing happens, can I say that it will survive for 30-40 years in service? Can anyone say like that? Is it okay if I test it for 1 hour, I apply same 400 kV for 1 hour or 1 day or 1 minute, whatever it is, and then can I say that okay, it passed the test, you go and install on the line? Is it okay? What shall I do then? Is it okay? Somebody should answer. This is, you know, simple common sense answer only.
No, sir.
Yeah, no. But then what should I do? How to believe? What? No, if
sir, we have to change the schedule form. To convert the high voltage into the low voltage, like millivolt.
No, no, that is okay. No, conversion is okay, everything is working. But if I tested the rated voltage only, then will it survive for 30-40 years? If I test it at the rated voltage only, means it is designed for working at 400 kV. I have tested it in the laboratory also for 400 kV. But I have limited time testing only. 1 minute or 1 hour or 1 day. Limited time testing only. Yeah, so actually, I have to increase the voltage. For testing, I cannot test at the same voltage and then say that it will work for 30, 40 years. Therefore, depending on the customer or depending on the standard for each equipment is tested for a higher voltage, say 1.2 times or 2 times the rated voltage, and then if it passes for 1 minute or 1 hour, it depends on the standards, it depends on the customer needs also. Some customers demand that we need this kind of test to be conducted, and if it passes that test, then only we will purchase from you. So like that, customers may demand the manufacturing companies to test for so much time at so much voltage. So normally they demand for higher voltage. So they are purchasing for installing on a 400 kilovolt transmission line, but they want it to be tested roughly around 500 kV for 1 minute. If it works 500 kV for 1 minute, then yes, it may be concluded based on the standards, of course, that it will survive for so much time, maybe a few 20, 30 years, for so much time at the operating voltage. So this is how testing is done for power frequency voltages. But then testing with lightning impulse voltages, testing with switching impulse voltages, you know, all equipment before installation need to be tested for lightning impulse voltages also and switching impulse voltages also. As I told, above 350 kV, which is important, lightning or switching? This is just to test whether you are listening or not. Repeat, please. Above 350 kV, which is important, lightning or switching? Switching is important. Yes, switching is important. Natural phenomena has a certain limitation. But as the system size increases, switching dominates because huge transients will occur because huge energy is associated with the system. So, switching dominates beyond 350 kV. Lightning importance goes down. But below 350 kV, lightning is important. So, lightning impulse voltages, which are actually shorter in time and have limited in charge compared to switching impulse voltages, need to be tested. The power equipment need to be tested with lightning impulse voltages if the system is less than 350 kV, because there the lightning phenomena is huge. So then what kind of lightning voltages are generated when the lightning occurs, and what kind of voltages are generated when switching occurs, that we need to understand. So the level of lightning impulse voltage or switching impulse voltage, so these are, there are standards. So at standard voltage levels, we have to test the power equipment for these voltages and then say, yes, this passed the lightning test also, this passed the switching test also. And then you can use the power equipment, say a transformer, for installation in the power line. Now then there is another testing, DC voltage testing. So DC voltage testing is actually used for power cables. Now power cables, what will happen, you know, if you test the power cable with power frequency voltages, for example, if the cable length is long, cable is itself a cylindrical capacitor. So when you are testing a capacitor and when you are applying a voltage at power frequency, then huge charging current will flow at power frequency itself. Therefore, testing a cable, no load testing, testing a cable with power frequency voltages is very difficult because of huge charging voltage, charging current in a laboratory. So therefore, what is done is they will be tested at a DC voltage. With the DC voltage, capacitor is open, so it does not take current at all. Unless only in the during the transient phase it will take some current. Otherwise, testing current is almost zero if the load is disconnected. Of course, when you are testing, load is normally disconnected. Only cable is tested. So DC voltage test has come into picture due to that reason. Also, of course, you know, if the line itself is DC, you have to obviously test in DC. But normally the lines are, you know, 50 hertz transmission lines in our country. So, AC testing, testing of power frequency voltages is done in AC only. But only for cables, we go for DC voltage testing. But there were questions by some organizations, and then there are also problems when a cable is tested with DC, but the moment they installed it and then switched on, it failed. So the reason then, you know, people did not accept DC voltage testing. So then how to go about it? That's why the last type of testing came into picture, that is VLF testing, very low frequency testing. So instead of going for power frequency testing, the frequency of the testing voltage is reduced drastically in order to reduce the current, charging current. So that kind of testing is called very low frequency testing. This is again for the cables only, for testing the cables only, just to reduce the current requirement. So these are the basic testing voltages that a power equipment to be installed need to be tested in a laboratory. So now we concentrate more on lightning and switching in this lecture. But before that, I will briefly introduce the other types of voltage generation in a laboratory. Why in a laboratory we need to test? Because before installation, we have to test them in the laboratory. In the laboratory, we do need to generate these high voltages. How we generate these high voltages in a laboratory, that we will see. So, generation of high voltages in a laboratory for testing of power equipment. So, we need three types actually. High voltage DC, high voltage AC, and impulse voltage. So, these three kinds of voltages need to be generated in a laboratory in order to test the power equipment. So, this is a DC voltage generator, high voltage DC generator. This is Cockcroft-Walton voltage multiplier, and it was part of one of the early particle accelerators responsible for the development of atomic bomb. It was built in 1937 by Philips of Eindhoven. It is now in the National Science Museum in London, England. So this is high voltage DC generator. How it works? It is very simple voltage multiplier circuit. So this is the fundamental circuit of AC to DC conversion. There is a transformer and a rectifier and then a capacitor. So it is half wave rectifier actually. This is the basic circuit. But the multiplier circuit is a little bit different. So this kind of multiplier circuit is used for generating voltage. This is called Cockcroft-Walton circuit. So it is simply, this is the AC source, and first this capacitor gets charged, and using this diode again this capacitor gets charged, and after that this capacitor gets charged. Like this, the voltage gets multiplied. So at this stage, you get for n capacitors 2nV, n stages 2nV, the voltage that will be developed here. So this is how high voltage DC is generated. And there is another way, of course, to generate high voltage DC. This is what is known as Van de Graaff generator. Simply in this, the technique is the charge here, using a needle here, the charge is sprayed by using some high voltage generator here, high voltage source here, that continuously put the charges on this, and there is a belt actually. This belt will physically take the charges and deposit on this sphere. This sphere acts as a capacitor. So we are depositing charge on a capacitor indirectly. Mechanically, we are taking the charges using a belt and depositing on a capacitor. So the capacitor voltage Q is equal to V is proportional to voltage. V is proportional to charge. V is directly proportional to charge. So as charge increases on this, the voltage increases continuously. So this is how the voltage is generated. This is again DC voltage. This is known as Van de Graaff generated. So here there is, the picture shown is Oak Ridge National Laboratory. It generates around 20 megavolt of voltage. So it is very, very high voltage in the world. Next comes alternating voltages. Alternating voltages means simple transformation only. Transformers are used. Low voltage to high voltage. So in a laboratory you get 230 volts only. That can be used for generating roughly around 300 kilovolts. So single units are used for 150 kilovolts. Multiple double units are used for 300 kilovolts. But for both these we use just 230 volts supply. So these are two single unit transformers shown here. So this is again cascaded transformer set. So these are, you can see that this transformer and this transformer and one more transformer is there here. These transformers feed each other actually. So this is first transformer and this is second transformer, third transformer. What is done here is there is an extra winding here. This extra winding is used to feed the other next transformer. So then this transformer generates again high voltage here, and then extra winding again is connected to the third stage. So like this, the output is this, this is primary, this is a secondary, this is tertiary or auxiliary winding. Now here, this is V. Again, this is V. This is V. So these V are connected in series actually. So 3V is the voltage generated. So this is how by cascading the transformers, known as cascaded transformer set, we can generate higher voltages. So you can see this in CPRI, 1600 kilovolts, 6 ampere power frequency voltage generated. So this again cascaded generator only. Here you can see this first stage, second stage, third stage, and then finally this is the voltage. You can see the size of the structures. So this is actually one of the oldest generator here again. This is first transformer, this is second transformer and third transformer. You can see the human being sitting on that. So the size you can imagine. So then there are other kinds of transformers known as resonant transformers. So it is very simple, resonance principle is used here. So then the voltage is generated across CT. But here, it is an advantage actually. So the resonance when resonance occurs, the load is very small, only resistive component will be the load actually. So the losses are also very less during that time. But high voltage is generated across the test equipment. This is CT is the test equipment. Maybe a transformer, maybe a cable, maybe any power equipment. So these are resonant transformer sets actually. This is Hitachi Japan. So in this laboratory I worked for 4 years actually. And then this is a 1200 kV series resonant transformer. This is Akhil Electronics, India. This is in Gujarat. And then power HV resonant transformers. You can see how big the resonant transformers are. So then we go to our topic, that is lightning and switching impulse voltage generation. First of all, let us see what is lightning and switching impulse voltage. So actually lightning is a natural phenomenon. So this happens during thunderstorms. So during thunderstorms, you know, the central part of the storm actually, where the air will be moving upwards, and then the rain, you know, means the particles of rain, they will be moving downwards. So here there will be a friction actually, or collisions among these particles. The cold particles moving upwards and then the downward particles. Then the charges are generated here. So the main charging area in a thunderstorm occurs in the central part of the storm, where the air is moving upward rapidly, that is updraft, and the temperatures range from minus 15 to minus 25 degrees centigrade. So in this area, let us see how this is how electrification means charge formation. You can see the positive charges going upwards, the red portion, and the negative charges going downwards. When the rising ice crystals collide with graupel, the ice crystals become positively charged, and the graupel becomes negatively charged. Graupel is that which is falling down, that is causing the rain actually. So this is how the electrification will occur in the central part, Then entire picture I will show you. So this is the central part, and the positive charges go and accumulate at the top of this thing, and negative charges will be going down like this. So the upper part of the thunderstorm cloud becomes positively charged, while the middle to the lower part of the thunderstorm cloud becomes negatively charged. And there may be a breakdown from this top to the bottom within the cloud also. And there may be a breakdown from this top to the ground also. So there are several types of, discharge activity that can take place within the cloud and between two clouds and from cloud to ground. So there are three possibilities. We are concerned with the cloud to ground. That cloud to ground phenomena may occur on a transmission line also. So, the charge that can strike here, you can see some sort of transmission line getting affected by this lightning strike. Then when it strikes, huge charge will flow into the line and huge voltage. Hello, some question? Please switch off or mute your mic if you are not asking me any question. So this is how lightning will strike a transmission line. Here also there is hazardous lightning striking the line is shown here, very complex way. So yeah, actually, we do have protective mechanism. There is a wire at this top corner. You might have noticed just now, at least you notice now. There is a wire. This is on the top of the tower. At the top of the tower. This is a wire actually. That wire is known as guard wire. It is simply a grounded wire that is going from the top of the line. This is used for protecting the transmission line actually. These are actually the conductors, live conductors, which are at high voltages. But this wire which goes on the top of the tower is just called a guard wire. So it is used to protect the transmission line from lightning. It has certain protecting angle actually. So this is how, within this angle, whatever comes, it is supposed to protect. But in spite of having this guard wire, lightning will not always occur only on the guard wire, but sometimes it does It is, you know, there is a limitation of this God wire actually. It is not a 100% probability actually. So certain probability is always there that lightning will occur, lightning will strike these transmission line conductors. So that will create a wave, you know, that will create a wave that will move on the transmission line in either direction. And even if it strikes sometimes, you know, the tower itself, then what will happen, due to huge charge, there may be a local voltage developed and there may be a flashover, because here high voltage is generated, there may be a flashover to the conductor. So that kind of phenomenon may also occur in spite of having a earth wire or guard wire or shield wire at the top of the transmission line. Then what will happen? What kind of voltages will be generated? That we need to see. So this is another thing. This is the previous slide was about lightning activity. Now I am showing a switching over voltage here. See, switching over voltage. See, these three are the rods which are connecting actually three phases. So these three are the rods which are connecting three phases. Now when it is connected, you can see here there is an arc here. So, but why do you think that only two arcs are there, the third one there is no arc? Anyone? Hello? Speak something, you know, don't feel shy. You have to interact.
Sir, maybe distance.
No, not at all. All will move simultaneously. All will have equal distance. Okay. They will move simultaneously and they will have equal distance with the terminal which they are going to connect. That's for sure. Of course, in three dimension, in this photograph, you may not visualize that, but that's for sure. That is not the reason. But I appreciate that you answered something. Yeah, others. See, logically thinking, that is some logically he has thought. You also have to do. Others, please. Okay, I am giving some hint. How the voltages will be in three phases? Have you seen three phase voltages? Three sinusoidal voltages of three different phases. At any given instant of time, what will be typically, what will be the voltages of different lines? Yeah, they are shifted by 120 degrees in phase. Then at a given point of time, two of them can be at higher voltage, the third one can be at lower voltage. So, this is how you can see, two of them are striking here, there is an arc here, because there is a high voltage, and the third one is not like that. So, then when such kind of switching activity occurs, so this kind of recovery voltage, transient recovery voltage it is called. So that kind of oscillations will occur. You can see here the voltage oscillations clearly. It is a transient recovery voltage. It is called transient recovery voltage. And after that it is completely smooth recovery voltage. But this transient period you will see such kind of waveform. So therefore your power system equipment need to be tested for such kind of waveform. So these are called, you know, switching over voltages. Now, after an observation of lightning phenomenon, natural lightning phenomenon, and then switching phenomenon, then in the laboratory we have to generate such waveforms actually. But here I am showing you standard impulse voltages, but these are not the voltages that are generated exactly when the lightning strikes or switching occurs. These are standard impulse voltages that are decided by working groups and standards. So IEEE or SIGRE or IEC or national standards. So these are world standards actually for lightning waveform as well as switching waveform. So you can see these are not actually the generated waveform. For example, when lightning phenomenon occurs, it is probabilistic in nature, but overall trend follows like this. Initially it will rise and then it will go down, decrease. So this is how the voltage will be generated, and the rising is very fast and decreasing the voltage is very slow. So this is how the typical the standard lightning impulse times are given here, 1.2 by 50 microseconds. Means 1.2 microseconds is the front time. So within 1.2 microseconds it will rise, and then 50 microseconds is the time to 50%. So this is the time to 50% of the wave. So this is how the standard lightning impulse is defined. So there is a other the other waveform, that is switching impulse voltage. Now you have seen in the previous slide there are several oscillations, but we are concerned with the first oscillation where the voltage is high. So for switching impulse voltage, this is the standard waveform that is decided. So the initial rise time is 250 microseconds, and the fall time, the time to 50%, is 2500 microseconds. So compared to lightning, switching is a bit slower phenomenon, but the voltage may be higher compared to lightning when the voltage of the power system increases beyond 350 kilovolts. So 1.2 by 50 microsecond lightning is very fast, and 250 by 2500 microseconds is a bit slower compared to the lightning. So these two are the basic impulse, standard impulse voltages that are used for testing the power equipment. These are generated in the laboratories for testing the power equipment, because the natural phenomena will always be having lot of oscillations actually. A lot of oscillations will be there, but the waveform more or less will follow like this. That's how it is decided that we test in a standard laboratory using such kind of waveforms, these standard waveforms. All the power equipment need to pass the tests of these waveforms before being installed in the power system. So here there is another two different waveforms actually. So this is a chopped wave it is called. So it is exactly just cutting this waveform in between. Why this kind of waveforms are used is sometimes lightning arrestors are used on transmission systems. These arrestors will chop these waveforms, means they will strike or they will bypass this lightning wave to the ground. So when that chopping activity occurs on a transmission line, the waveform that is visible on the transmission line looks like this. So this is how the voltages are generated actually. So these are called chopped lightning voltages. So these are the basic types of lightning voltages that are generated in testing laboratories for testing the power equipment. Now how to generate them? So can anyone has any idea how a impulse like this waveform can be generated at high voltages in a laboratory? So let us see. So this is a typical circuit. These are the typical circuits that can be used for generating impulse voltages. So the impulse voltage shown in the previous slide can be approximated as double exponential. So one exponential is rising, another exponential is decaying. So these, here this is rising exponential, this is a decaying exponential. The sum of these two exponentials will become like this actually. So this kind of waveform is called double exponential wave. So these double exponential wave can be generated using such kind of circuit. So in this circuit you can see here, there is a capacitor here. This capacitor is initially charged to V0. And here there is two spheres and there is a gap. This is known as sphere gap assembly. So when the capacitor voltage is increased to a certain level, then this gap breaks actually. It acts like a switch. Simply this acts like a switch. And when this is this switch is on, this capacitor discharges to this capacitor through this R1. This R1 is very small compared to R2. Therefore, basically this will flow like this. R2 is very huge. That's why this current flows basically charges C2. But after charging C2, the C2 will slowly discharge through the resistor R2. So while charging, it is very quick. And while discharging, it is very slow. Just by having a value of R2 very much higher than R1. That's it. So you will have a fast rising voltage of C2. This is output voltage actually, where the voltage is generated. So very fast rising voltage of C2 when this gap strikes, and when the C2 is fully charged, then it will, because the, by that time C1 is gets discharged. So when C2 is fully charged, the C2 again gets discharged through this R2, but it is a slow activity. So this is one exponential wave, this is another exponential wave, that is the sum of these two exponential waves is the voltage V of T. So this is how in a laboratory the voltage double exponential wave is generated. This also same circuit, only that this R2 is shifted from here to here. But it doesn't matter, as already I told you, R1 is very small value compared to R2. Therefore, adding R1 plus R2 doesn't increase, doesn't have much significance actually. But this is also one of the way we can generate the same kind of double exponential wave with, of course, different values of the R1 and R2. Of course, this is equivalent circuit for analysis. You can simulate these, or you can just solve this, and then finally you will get such a waveform. So this is how in the laboratory, basic principle, this is the basic principle actually. Of course, actual generating circuit is very complex that I will show you. I am running short of time actually. I have another meeting also. So I will show those circuits, how the basic concept is same. But it is very complex circuit, why, how this C1 is charged and how these resistors are arranged, that is a different, you know, way that is done. Because, you know, the single unit generator can generate only, there is a maximum voltage limit for this single circuit. Therefore, we have to use here also a multiplier circuit, just like for DC we have seen. So this is the Marx impulse generator circuit actually. So this concept is same. These capacitors, this is not active capacitor, this is just to explain the concept. These are the capacitors actually. These are the capacitors which are used here. They will be charged in parallel and then discharged in series using these sphere gap assembly. So all sphere gaps will strike at one time, and you can see this is ground, and once the capacitors are charged to a certain voltage, now this is ground, this is V, and then plus V, 2V, and then plus V, 3V, and then plus V, 4V, and then 5V, and then 6V, like this. So you can generate high voltages at this end. Here this is passing through R1. And when this C2 is charged, it will reach its to its peak. And then when it is discharged, then voltage slowly decreases at this end. This is the output voltage actually. Here, there, this point is the output voltage. And when it discharges through this R2 dash, R2 dash, R2 dash, R2 dash, R2 dash. So basically, this multiplier circuit is exactly same as this second circuit actually. The second circuit. So only that you have multiple, you know, elements here, which are, you know, arranged in a complex way. The C1 dash, C1 dash, C1 dash, etc. are simply the C1, combinedly act as a C1 actually, but they will be charged in different, in a parallel, because we cannot have a very high voltage generator to charge the C1, this C1 capacitor. So they will be charged in parallel and connected in series when the triggering happens, so that high voltage is generated here and that charges the capacitor C2, and when it discharges, then the voltage will slowly decay. So this is how in a laboratory very high impulse voltage is generated. See, the same circuit can be used for generating switching voltage also, lightning voltage also. But the difference is in the use, in the components, you know, R1, R2 values, etc. you have to adjust, because time constants should be different. Lightning is faster than the switching activity. So in case of lightning, we need 1.2 by 50 microseconds. But in case of switching, we need 250 by 2500 microseconds. Therefore, R1, C1, the time constant should be different from, different in R2, C2. These time constants should be different for impulse wave, lightning impulse and switching impulse. So this need to be considered actually. The values only will be different. Other than that, there will not be any difference actually. So to generate high impulse voltages. Now this is another way of generating the, this also marks only, but in this case this resistance is divided like this. So there is a slight difference, but this again same, you know, parallel charging and series discharging, and then this is the R1 dash, R1 double dash, and here R1 dash is there, and again C2 will be charged, and C2 again gets discharged through this path. So this is how impulse voltages are generated in a laboratory. And oscillating impulses also generated actually. As you have seen, the transient recovery voltage is having such kind of oscillations. So sometimes we need to generate such kind of oscillations, because some customers will demand that our power equipment need to be tested in such kind of oscillating voltage waves only, not that standard lightning voltages and all. So in that case, we have to introduce a small inductor, because oscillations will occur only if you have all three component R, L, C. So that L component is missing. Of course, you know, every wire will have some inductance, but that inductance may not be prominent. So we use such kind of choke or inductor to generate such a oscillating waveform. So this is how oscillating waves are also generated in the laboratory. Now I am showing you typical lightning impulse voltage generators. So every lab will have, you know, highest lightning impulse voltage generator actually, because lightning impulse voltages are need to be much higher than the operating voltages for testing the power equipment. So always the laboratories will have very high lightning impulse voltages. So this is 3200 kilovolts or 3.2 megavolts generator, impulse generator, and this is 1.6 megavolts, and this is an again indoor generator of in China. So these are the lightning impulse voltage generators, and we also have at IIT Roorkee one small lightning impulse voltage generator, which can generate 430 kilovolts. So thank you very much. Now if you have any questions, you may please ask me quickly. Do you have any questions? Okay, so if there are no questions, then we will close.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, you are welcome. I hope you got students got some information. So you are welcome to ask me anytime. By email you can send if you have any questions.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.